A generation ago, the United States had the most educated population in the world. Today, we're no longer first in the world in educational attainment, but for our rates of incarceration, we're number one. We lock up a greater share of our population than any other industrialized nation. More than 2 million Americans are in prison today. We must end mass incarceration and expand access to education. Otherwise, we are essentially locking up the very idea of America and throwing away the key. Our nation's promise is that it is a place where all people, through hard work and determination, can make of their lives whatever they choose. Individual choices matter, but so do structural barriers. Too many Americans, particularly people of color and people from low-income backgrounds, face constrained choices due to limited access to opportunity, inadequate educational experiences, insufficient preparation for the workforce, and institutional racism and bias. And far too many of our most vulnerable people wind up involved in the criminal justice system, a system we must change at every level. We need policing reform. We need plea bargain and bail reform. We need sentencing reform. We need to shift our response to addiction from incarceration to treatment. We need to shift our response to trauma from incarceration to mental health services. We need to transform the conditions of incarceration. And we need to rethink our approach to reentry so that those who were formerly incarcerated have the ability to earn a good job, pursue more education, secure decent housing, and have the ability to vote. At the same time, we have to improve our education system. The school-to-prison pipeline shuttles far too many Americans into a negative future, people of color in particular, and it starts from an early age. Low-income communities and communities of color typically do not have robust access to early childhood education. And when they do, children of color are suspended from preschool at alarming rates. Black children represent 18% of preschool enrollment, for example, but 48% of out-of-school suspensions. Babies, four-year-olds, suspended from school. And in our K-12 schools, African-American students are suspended and expelled at a rate three times higher than white students. We also know that nationally, we're not providing students, especially the most vulnerable, with enough supports. There are 1.6 million students in schools where there's a sworn law enforcement officer, but no school counselor. We see this same misguided prioritization in public funding decisions. Between 1989 and 2011, state and local budgets for corrections expanded 11 times as quickly as higher education spending. Budgets reflect values. In states and communities across this country, we should be investing in education, not doubling down on mass incarceration. Dismantling the school-to-prison pipeline means making universal, high-quality early childhood education a reality in every neighborhood. It means pushing for increased supports in our schools, ending discriminatory and excessive discipline practices, providing wraparound services for health and housing, ensuring low-income students and students of color have equal access to effective teachers, and making sure all kids can attain a well-rounded, rich education that includes not just English and math, but science and social studies and the arts and the opportunity to learn a second language. It also means restoring Pell Grants for prison education so that our nation truly does live up to its ideals as a land of second chances. And it means supporting and growing basic and higher education programs for those who are incarcerated and those who were formerly incarcerated. We know from a RAND study that participation in any education program while incarcerated lowers recidivism by 43%. We know from the experiences of programs at places like Goucher College in Maryland or Bard College in New York, or the work that you are now a part of at Columbia, that education in prison not only provides critical skills for success after incarceration, but can also provide hope and a vision for the future. Given that according to the National Resource Center on Children and Families of the Incarcerated, approximately 10 million children have parents who are currently in prison or who have spent time in prison, this work has multi-generational significance. The work can be hard, but it's the right work. Thank you for everything you are committed to doing to make our society more just. Through your efforts, we have a chance to fulfill the hopes of every child and every adult in the country who wants the American dream to mean something for them. Thanks.